Thanks for listening to another episode of the Gifted Performance Podcast. If you're listening or watching on YouTube, make sure you subscribe, as well as hitting the like button and the notification bell so you never miss a video. If you prefer audio format, search Gifted Performance on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, Google Podcasts, or your favorite podcasting service and subscribe today. Make sure you also rate and review the podcast, as that helps us out tremendously. Enjoy the podcast and stay gifted. Welcome back, guys. Another episode of the GPP, the Gifted Performance Podcast, where we give you the knowledge and practical takeaways to improve your own general physical preparedness. I am joined today by a special guest. He's been on an absolute content tear recently, Mr. Zach Tellander. Is it Tellander or
Tellander? Tellander. Yeah.
Okay. Because
I'll take both. I'll take both, actually.
And then I hear other people say Tellander.
Yeah.
Like, I think this guy knows how to pronounce his own name.
Yeah. Well, actually, what's interesting is I've gotten Tellander my whole life.
Oh.
But Tellander is actually a more accurate representation of like the Swedish word. It's Swedish last name. So, you know, Tellander. If you think of the movie Girl with the Dragon Tattoo. Her last name is Lisbeth Salander.
Oh.
And they have the emphasis on the and, you know, Salander, Tellander. So it would be accurate, but my whole life, you know, my dad and his dad, they all said Tellander. So that's what we are.
That's a great movie. That girl Tickle Your Fancy. Is that up your alley?
What, that type of chick?
That genre of chick.
Just kind of like goth, but and like psychotic.
Yeah.
I mean,
like
I think
medicine cabinet.
I think a lot of men have a certain level of attraction to that, but when the reality hits in and you're living with someone like that, it might be a different story.
You know what? Yeah, that's some deep insight right there. So for those who may not know, Zach is the host of the podcast formerly known as the Training Make Podcast. I've just been told that he's got a new podcast. Do we get a name here?
Yeah, Telly's Talks.
Oh, fucking, I love it. I love it. I'm being told that it is just an outlet for Zach's rants, which, you know, if you're here watching this video, you've been subjected to two of those before and you love them. Zach is the creator of strategically and creatively named videos, hit videos like You Are Not Lou and You Are Not Klokov. How'd you come up with those names?
Well, actually, what's interesting is one of my buddies he's a really good writer. And it's funny, he posted to Reddit, and what he posted to Reddit, I was like, my God, like, this is, write out my thoughts on this particular topic. And it was about mobility. This is back in, I think, 2015. And I think mobility was an interesting place. You know, if you think about mobility WOD, which I don't know what it's called now. It's like the state ready state. It's with Kelly Starrett.
Yeah.
Right? Everyone had that. Everyone knew about that. Right. And a lot of it was just stretching and myofascial release and all this stuff. And his thing was like, you know, none of that should be taken further than, you know, entirely placebo. Right. The science does not match up with those things. And he went through and listed all this, and it was a Reddit post. It probably took him like hours to write. And I was like, God damn, you're very good at writing. He's like, thank you so much, man. I've got a lot of other stuff. I'm like, hey, would you mind writing something for me? And so he wrote the You Are Not Klokov video. And then I threw in a couple edits to it because I wanted to implement my own opinions or further some things. And then I voiced that over. I recorded it. And then I edited it for like forever. And then that name, You Are Not Klokov, the reason we said it was because it's kind of this fallacy in the strength world. It's like, you know, Klokov does it, so I want to do it. You know, there are certain tendencies and differences that elite people have in any sport, any strength training endeavor that you do. Elite people are going to do certain things, but you are not them, meaning you haven't gone through like the 10 years of training to where they found out that one little thing that helps them and they do that particularly. It might help you, but that doesn't mean because they're good that it always will. And that was literally the thesis behind that video. People succeed despite their flaws, not because of them.
Yeah. I think people attach themselves to whether it's people, whether it's a system, you know, people attach, like, I'm going to train like Klokov. I'm going to train like Liu. I'm going to train within the Chinese system. I'm going to train within the Bulgarian system. And because I'm subjecting myself to that system or that training, thus my results will be of that system.
Exactly. And Liu, You Are Not Liu was more of a spinoff of that. It didn't have to be called that. And the point of that, again, was furthermore, it was like, let me point out why Liu Zhaojun is so successful and why his tendencies should not be copied. And for those listening, Liu Zhaojun is a very, very decorated weightlifter who's also just like aesthetically pleasing. His body, you know, he looks like a bodybuilder and people love him. Like, people are super fanboys over him. And one of the things that he does is a squat jerk. And again, for the people listening, when you do a clean and jerk, you get the bar up to your shoulders or to your front rack, and then you get it overhead. And I'd say 98% of all elite weightlifters are going to be doing a split jerk variation. You know, the rest are going to be doing a power jerk variation where it's just both feet stay in line. And then some will, because the weight is heavy, get pushed down into like this hybrid between a full squat and a power. And then some, like Liu Zhaojun, very, very few. Like, I don't really know many others that don't even attempt to stop the bar high. They legitimately drop, they descend directly into a squat. That is something that is completely different than what anyone does or what I would say should do. And that's the point of that video. That's all those things were. It just so happened they were packaged well and they viralized, you know. The thing is, I don't look to viralize my videos, and the moment that I do is like, I'm going to be doomed. You know, I just want to make things that I agree with or things that I have to say. I have to say things, so I'm going to say them and put visuals over the top so people can understand them. But that was something that I wanted to say. And it just so happened that it went, you know, I don't know how many views it has, 3 million or something like that. It's ridiculous. I can't even fathom that. I think my channel has like 11 million views total. So we're looking at...
They're doing the heavy lifting.
Yes, exactly.
So, I mean, that was a point in your content creation career when you probably had, you know, thousands, maybe tens of thousands of followers. And then you kind of hit a very large inflection point. Just out of my own curiosity, what do you attribute that hockey stick in views, subscribers, all of that to? Consistency?
Yeah, I mean, I'm always going to gain subscribers. I always have, right? It's the amount that I gain is like, it's ethereal. It's like, you can never, you can't hack this system unless you find something creative that you're doing, and then you can hack it for a long time. And then when other people try to hack it, it becomes saturated and it's ruined. I mean, that's literally any sort of content creation. I can think of a bunch of content creators who have watched explode. We talked earlier before the show about More Plates, More Dates. Well, what his thing is, like, if you look at YouTube, the algorithm, it actually promotes view time. It doesn't give a fuck about, sorry, am I allowed to swear?
Absolutely. It's encouraged.
Okay. It doesn't give a fuck about subscribers, how many videos you have. It doesn't care about anything other than view time. And so it's going to push videos that are over 10, 11 minutes long. And then it's going to also push the guys who repeat those videos many times. So Derek will make 2-3 videos a day. If something comes to him, and it's great. He's got this sick generation of content, right? So like, he's got a lot of fans who go into his DMs and they say, look at this shit. And he goes, oh my God, I'm going to make a video of that. He presses the record button, starts making a video. It's great. People want to hear him talk. People want that. It's for me, it's like a little cheap, right? To just press record and go. It's a little bit cheap. I've started to do it a little bit more. But I'm a little bit more picky when it comes to things that I want to focus on. But as far as my success and just gaining subscribers, it's as simple as this. Like, I was at a place where like, I was kind of taking a downturn in my career. I came from strength and conditioning background. I was, an assistant, at Texas A&M strength
conditioning. You were getting paid dog shit. Just be like, hey guys, I was getting paid dog shit.
Yeah. So I was an assistant at strength and conditioning at Olympic side of Texas A&M sports. So, you know, swimming, track and field, whatever. Just everything but the big money makers. So football, baseball, basketball all had separate facilities, separate coaches. The Olympic sports is where we were. I don't know. I don't think I just didn't really want to be a part of that anymore. I didn't see the end goal as being something that I wanted to be a part of, which is there's no issues there. It's just I wanted to move on. So I became a personal trainer a personal trainer at Gold's Gym with a CSCS, a USAW level 2, CrossFit level 2 for whatever that's worth. You know, all these certifications. I had NCSF, like all this bullshit. To be in a Gold's Gym, like that's a little bit of an undershoot for me. But I didn't mind, you know, because I needed to make money somehow. And someone had gotten me to basically just look at YouTube. For me, YouTube originally was a place where I could just see videos, like viral videos. If someone wanted to send me a video that wasn't professionally made, and it was funny, that's how they sent it, was YouTube. That's how I thought of it. And in 2015, people started showing me like vloggers and like people that were actually called creators, right? That's what they did. They made content for YouTube and it wasn't viral shit. They just put it on their channel. And I was like, this is amazing. Like, I didn't know that this was what people are doing. And so what I did, I was like, I want to do that. So at the time I was personal training, weightlifting coaching, and then myself, I was doing CrossFit again just because I wanted to do something different. Like for me, CrossFit is something where I have no problems ripping on it. I understand it. That's why I understand it. But when I do CrossFit myself for my training, I like it because I'm under control. I'm smooth. I try to move technically as well as I can. And I just try to keep that technique while I'm fatigued. I do not try to push to the point where my technique looks like shit. The moment that you push where your technique looks like shit, I'm out, you know?
A meme. You've officially become a meme.
Yeah. So my first videos on YouTube were just like shitty vlogs of me doing CrossFit training. And like, I remember I put it on Reddit. And I was like, check out these videos on my YouTube. And one guy commented, he's like, you know, this isn't very good because you don't have a mission. You know, what's your goals? Like, are you going to try to go to regionals or whatever? Like, what's your thing? You're not like particularly strong. Like, you're not crazy strong. And you're not like a sex symbol like Brooke Entz or even like Rich Froning or whatever.
You're a sex symbol to some, Zach.
He's like, what are you? Like, what are you good at? And I was like, well, I'll tell you right now, I'm fucking good at teaching the Olympic lifts. And not only that, I'm good at teaching it to beginners because I'd literally done it thousands of times. So boom, switch. I got rid of all that garbage in my YouTube. I almost wish I saved it so I could like laugh about it. But I got rid of all that and I made my first video and it got a few thousand views. I was like, holy shit, this is crazy. And I remember I got emails whenever I got a subscriber. And I got like 25 emails one night and I was like, oh my God, this is amazing. So from that day, and I don't know what day it was, it could have been 2016 or 2017. I've made a video every single week. And that's it. I just didn't stop. Here's another idea. Here's another video. Here's another idea for however many weeks, 200 weeks straight. And that's what got me to, I think I have 128,000 subscribers now. And, that is it. That is literally it. I found what people liked. And what they liked was my voice and the way that I would put things out there. And I just kept doing it over and over and over again. And I still do it over and over again. I just made a video less than an hour ago and posted it. So
Zach is about all things weightlifting, did some CrossFit, did some S&C in his life. Before all of that dominated your life, I believe you had a career in lacrosse.
Yes.
What else were you into?
So growing up, I did like too many sports. I like most little kids, you do karate. And then my family was a swimming family. So my sister swam Division One, but actually two of my sisters swam Division One. They played water polo as well. And then, you know, my dad played football in college at Northwestern University and then was drafted by the Kansas City Chiefs. And then, you know, so my whole life I've been playing everything under the sun. I swam. I even did diving. I did, you know, lacrosse, track and field, football, basketball. But then once I got to high school, it was just football and lacrosse. By my junior year, I'd gotten a scholarship to University of Vermont for lacrosse. And then, you know, that was my next 4 years. And I think that's really, the moment I got in the gym when I was like 13 was the moment I decided, like, I'm just never going to not be training. Like, I'm never going to not want to grow my muscles. Like, I remember that moment vividly. So
your training career through your sporting history, was there exposure to the Olympic weightlifting movements, or were you just a bench and biceps kind of guy?
Well, actually, interestingly enough, we had a strength and conditioning coach that was fucking insane at the University of Vermont.
That sounds about right.
And he ended up, you know, having a massive pill addiction and he was fired. But we did hang cleans from above the knee with straps and just hang power clean, just basically grip and rip. And it's a very remedial elementary movement, and I still do them to this day. And it was like my freshman year, I remember I did like 120 kilos, but it was horrible, man. Horrible. Like, if there was video of it, like, I would destroy that evidence. So that was my exposure then. And what I can say is those, like, what they did to my upper back and my just general standing power. Like, standing power, what I mean is like your ability to just like manipulate things with your upper body while you're in a full standing position. Like, that changed my life. And when I started weightlifting, I had that little bit of an advantage from that. And I still do them to this day, the hang power cleans with the straps, obviously much more technically sound, but that was it. That was my exposure there. Other than that, it was squats, bench press, you know, gym stuff.
I'm glad that movement exists in like traditional S&C at the D1 college level, because you can see these throwers doing like 200 kilos for triples hang powers. And it's like, anyone who ever says, you know, America, the US will never have a good super heavy to throw out there, it's like, show them these guys that are tripling 200, 210 from a hang with straps with quite literally zero technique. It's like, there's your great super heavy right there. This is what could be.
Yeah, we have the best shot putters in the world right now. We have two of the best, Kovacs and Ryan Krauser. I don't know Kovacs' first name, something, but they're fucked up strong, like fucking crazy strong. So throwers, also football players. Yeah, I could dive down this rabbit hole about weightlifting movements. Because I've heard it all, man. Like, there's people who are staunchly against them for no real reason. I think they're, you know, they're so frightened by the gatekeeping weightlifting community that they've created these kind of indisputable arguments against the Olympic lifts themselves. And those arguments, they're false in their own like creation. They shouldn't be there in the first place. Like, I can simplify them, and I've continually argued against them over and over again. Basically, long story short, people think that variants of the snatch and variants of the clean and jerk should not be used in strength and conditioning for a gamut of reasons. And I disagree wholeheartedly.
Well, I think the most common one is that it's a risk reward ratio, right? Is that the risk of those movements for these athletes that have never been exposed to them in their life is high, and the reward is kind of is on the lower end. And then you also inject into that scenario assistant S&C coaches who have probably never coached to
right.
the level
so
that you did.
What I would say is I would reverse those two, right? So I would say that's the problem.
It is.
That's the problem is people who 100%. Don't know how to coach them, not the actual danger of the movement.
Yes.
See, that's that. Yes. That's another thing too. I actually made an Instagram post pretty recently talking about dangerous movements or good or bad movements. There are no good or bad movements. There are good and bad people, right? So if you move poorly, and that is dependent on your own ability as an athlete, and then the load that you choose to use, if you move poorly, you will get injured. Both of those factors do not matter. Neither of those two factors have anything to do with the type of movement you decide to do. Right. So essentially, the road that I will continually go down is risk reward is actually not there. There's very limited risk. I mean, there's risk anytime you step into the weight room. Okay. But it's minimal. If you are under control and you're not a fucking idiot. Okay.
How is there not risk in having an offensive lineman do a four board bench with bands and chains with 400 pounds on the bar? How is there also not risk attached
to
that?
You know, if he's a full range of motion, 500 pound squatter, then it's not a risk. But if he's a like weak guy who just like arches his back and lifts his hips, yeah, it's fucking dangerous. So that's my thing is like the way that I teach the snatch and the clean and jerk or the clean. Right now I work with MMA athletes. So that's who I do strength and conditioning for in person every day. We just had a session today. And they all power clean and they all power snatch. They all front squat. They all back squat. They all bench press. But we also do carries. We also do grip work. We also do neck work. We also do standard things that will help them for their sport specifically. People think it's one or the other and it's not. But what I will say is then if it's not risky, like if you take my argument as it is, if it's not risky, then it's the time aspect, right? I don't have the time to teach these athletes a technical movement to get this when I can do something else and get something really fast. And what I would say is, well, if you're inept at teaching them, then yeah, you won't. But I teach motherfuckers how to power clean and power snatch in 20 minutes or less. We will get a full workout in. Trust me. They will get adaptation. Trust me. They will also learn how to power snatch and power clean safely. And then the gains that they will get from those safe movements 8 weeks from now will be innumerable. They will be greater than many, many other movements that you're getting benefits out of now. And that's just always been my philosophy. If you're not comfortable teaching the power clean, don't do it. If you aren't comfortable and you want to get comfortable, go learn it, go train it. But don't say that the movement is inherently bad and it's not worth it, because that's where I start to have issues with that. And dude, like, just fucking today, literally just today.
Just today, people.
Where's this?
People on here? Spotify. Zach is pulling up the Instagrams. He's going straight to the IGs. I think.
Yes.
Maybe here Google. Here we go.
So the big lie is that Olympic lifting helps a forward locomotive athlete. And if you look at it in slow motion, and you look at what the forward slow motion video athletes do, here's what you find. Let's say football, for example. When are you running around in football and the ball's in the air and you pay timeout, you reach down to get a barbell and you lift it up backwards? Think about it for a second. When do you do that? Never. When do you, in the middle of a basketball game, reach down, other than picking up the basketball, which weighs less than a pound?
Okay, so
is this GOTA? Are you subjecting the people to GOTA?
Yeah, this is them.
Oh, you've been GOTA'd, people.
Well, so I mean, I've had issues with them for years now, and I've done a debate with them. I've been on their radar. Yeah. And here's the thing is like, it's weaponized specificity. Okay. His argument for when are you going to bend over and pick something up? Like, Probably never. I don't fucking know, but that's not why we do this. People like weaponize specificity. Just because it is not within the exact specific bounds of your sport doesn't mean it's not fucking worthwhile. It's the reason why you guys are, your podcast is about general physical performance. Why would you want to be generally physically prepared when you could just go walk and run and there, that's it.
So I don't subject myself to the go-to folks too much just for my own sanity, but what does their actual training look like? Because if they are hyper specific with their training, the only real argument that they can make that holds water is that you should only play your sport.
So here's the here is their thing. This is their training methodology. You're broken. We're going to fix you. Then you're going to be amazing. That's it. That's their methodology. The way that you walk, the way that you run is broken. So we're going to fix that. And that's all you fucking need. You understand?
You know what?
The way that we fix you, that's it. And then don't do anything else.
So their methodology is marketing, basically.
Yes. That essentially their methodology has to come with the bounds that someone is wrong and they're correct. Always.
What did it for me with their videos was they had a video of Matt Frazier walking up to a bar and they said, "Here's a CrossFit athlete." And I was like, show some respect.
It's not that a CrossFit athlete. That is the CrossFit athlete.
That is the guy.
Yeah. Yeah.
So when we circle back to the safety of weightlifting, I think a lot of the injuries are consolidated. A lot of the upper body injuries are consolidated to the elbow specifically. And when we look at the elbow, there's a specific rule that has come under contention or some fire recently surrounding the elbow. And that is the rule of the press out with Kuo Sung Chung's latest world record. I think there's a lot of talk.
Yeah. And Matty Rogers and
Matty Rogers, Yangja, all of them. Maddie's was pretty shouldery. That one was.
I know. They all.
I'm not a Maddie savior though. So I asked this question to Seb. I want to get your opinion on it as well. Let's pro and con it. Pros and cons to eliminating the press out rule, because I believe you are on team abolish the press out.
Yeah, I mean the pro is just aesthetics, and that's it.
And the cons are.
It's the dumbest fucking rule on the face of the earth. It's so dumb because it makes a objective sport subjective. It makes you have to make real-time biomechanical assessments in, I'm talking less than a tenth of a fucking second, which is impossible. To understand how someone's elbow should be locked and then to see a shoulder go up and down. Also, by the way, shoulders internally and externally rotate. When that happens, the elbow can become a slightly less locked, or it can be locked and it just looks like it unlocked, and all these things happen. If you rotate your shoulders, like you have to walk out a snatch. God, you know, it's about making lifts on the fucking platform. If you rotate your shoulders, that shit is going to get a red likely. That's not the rule, by the way. That's not the fucking rule. We also see judges start to have grudges against people. Oh, this guy's a press outer. So next time he comes up, he's basically guilty until proven innocent. I've got my hand on the red here. And then he's got to prove to me why it's a good lift. Do you see it? Like, it's the 100%. The culture that surrounds it is what fucking sucks too. Other than the fact that it's an impossible judgment to make. Like, unless you're lenient, or unless you're not lenient, it's impossible to make. So what we have are lenient judges and non-lenient judges. So it's a fucking coin flip as to whether you make it if there's any sort of struggle at all, right? So our sport has turned into, it needs to look perfect or else it does not count. That's it.
But it needs not about the elbow. Objectively perfect. It needs to look perfect to me.
Yes. And that's true. And I would say, but generally that means your elbows need to snap locked, zero rotation in the shoulder at all, zero unlocking at all of either of the elbows. If it twinges a little bit, not good enough. And that's it. And it's a bullshit rule. It needs to go away. It absolutely needs to go away. 100%.
Yeah. I couldn't agree more. And then when you look at, so when you look at other sports where we have this process of a rule that continues to need, that continues to be reviewed. So I look at it like the, in the NFL, they have, you know, how pass interference can now be reviewed. So I see that as like the press out rule as well. So the argument against reviewing pass interference in the NFL is that it slows down the game. Okay, now anyone who's ever weightlifted before, put yourself in the shoes of the person who's up, who's the next lifter up, the lifter who's about to be called to the platform, and now you've got a press out, a jury review, a coach's challenge, and what was going to be your bar in 30 seconds is now your bar after 8 minutes and 30 seconds.
Yeah.
It is a rule that, in my opinion, quite literally makes the sport objectively worse.
Yeah. And I mean, it also is a defunct rule in that it never gets overturned. Yeah. It only gets overturned negatively when the jury decides to stop it. That's yeah. Not one coach's challenge has worked.
Yeah.
Since the implementation of it in, I don't know, 2 years ago. Yeah, not one. Not one.
So
unless someone can point it out to me, I've not seen one review seen that like a coach's challenge. Never. So it's dumb, right? Just take out the press rule and we'll be good. What you should have to do is have fully locked out elbows and hold the weight overhead. That should just be the only rule. Locked out elbows, hold it overhead until the down signal, right? If you have it, if your elbows are unlocked when the down signal comes and something like that. If you're able to stabilize and hold and they give you the down signal, it should always be a good lift. Always.
So, and I'm 100% agreement up front here. So what we've actually done, Gifted Performance, we're throwing a weightlifting meet where we've essentially pulled back those rules. We're calling it the Max Out or Blackout Classic, where you are allowed to press out lifts. You are allowed to elbow touch. You are allowed to butt touch. You can bar slam. You can talk shit. You can do all of that. We're keeping the essence of weightlifting, removing all of those terrible rules. We're giving people WWE style entries through the fog machine, music of their choice. You get a stage name to lift under. Zach, can we count on your attendance at the Max Out or Blackout Classic?
Yeah, for sure. I'd love to do that.
He's there.
I would love to do that.
We're giving away cash prizes. The cash will be in briefcases hung from the rafters that you will have to climb a ladder, WWE ladder match style, to retrieve your winnings. And honestly, I think you got a pretty good chance of winning if you had a good day.
I'm in for sure. That sounds amazing. Yeah.
We're going to make it. We're going to make it a raucous event. Now, something you did say that made me laugh a little bit was you said that some athletes become kind of like these specially judged athletes, like the judges just absolutely hate them. Now, why do you think that's Kianush Rastami?
No, I don't think it's
Does Maddie Rogers get the benefit of the doubt?
Well, so
free Kianush.
Yeah, I think, well, Kianush Rastami, his whole story is that
he's insane.
He's not very smart. I mean, he had multiple times. He didn't know the qualification process. And I'm sure Seb actually talked about this with you. He missed a lot of meets that he could have just totaled at, and then he would have been all clear. He didn't even total certain things that he needed to, like certain meets. All he needed to do was total, and then he bombed out. He like created this like little charade in front of the bar after missing at Worlds. But I guess when you put yourself more in that radar, like potentially the judges are going to have that predisposition to you. But I'm actually thinking more about like the lifters that I've coached and the lifters that I've seen lifting at nationals. And at national meets, if you lift and you have a bent elbow in one of your lifts and you're coming out again, they're eyeing you down now.
True.
Right. And I guess that's somewhat fair. But again, we're supposed to take each lift as they come.
As its own. Yep.
Yeah. You shouldn't have a bias, right? It's judgment with zero bias. And yet their bias seems to creep into all of these. But yeah, again, the press rule is just aesthetics and it's not objective at all. It takes away the objective nature of a completely objective sport, and it's bullshit.
Yeah. We had Kiyanush at the Asian Championships. We had a really good little run of weightlifting there. The live commentaries that you and Seb and everyone were doing were really fun to watch. Those are really cool.
Oh man, I had a blast doing those.
Oh, it looked fun. So in terms of standout lifters from those international championships, who really caught your eye across all of them? Asian, European, Pan Am.
I mean, obviously Europeans got to be Lasha and Laura Donatoma with the world record. Kuo Sing Chun with the world record in the Asian Games. Pretty much all of Team China.
Showing up and showing out.
Yeah, always, you know. I think, let's think, if we want to look at Americans that performed unbelievably well, you know, I think the number one is Jordan Dela Cruz.
Gotta be.
Now, interesting story about her with when Max was coaching Alyssa Ritchie, Jordan decided to bump down to Alyssa's class, where Alyssa was kind of the top dog in that 49 kilo class, because she wanted to gain some more Roby there. She thought it would be easier. And Max was upset about this because, you know, it's now another competitor against Alyssa, a potential competitor that could get in the way of her Olympic dreams. And he thought it was stupid. He's like, what, is she going to go down in weight and put up, you know, over 9 kilos more than Alyssa? And then literally that meet she did. And that was the Roma Cup meet. Those were some crazy lifts at that. And then she did even better at Pan Ams. I think she's by far the top performer right now. You know, I love seeing Nathan Damron put together a good total and make all of his lifts for once. It's the first time in his career ever doing 6 for 6. I liked, you know, Maddie. I think congrats to her. It's a big, you know, it's a big thing. Maddie was, I think her lift was shouldery, you know, it could have gone either way, but it probably was, you know, if it was ruled a press out, like I would have been like, yeah, kind of, you know, as far as the rules go. But again, that would have been total bullshit. I mean, think about Maddie's, you look at Maddie's prevalence on Instagram, you know, I don't know what percentage of those people actually watch weightlifting or give a fuck about weightlifting. I would imagine a very small portion of people that follow her do. I think she's got like 500,000 Instagram followers. And if she's about to post a lift and say, this didn't get counted, what does that say to the people who watch it? They're like, what the fuck is this sport? I don't get it. She lifted the bar over her head and stood there with it over her head. And then the judge said, you can drop the bar now from over your head. And that's not a fucking lift. What is the point of this sport? You know? So yeah, that again, Maddie, huge. And then CJ Cummings, just always doing what he needs
CJ
to do.
Things.
Yeah, he's always doing what he needs to do. It'll be interesting. He's got a tough shot, man. I don't think, I mean, the odds are stacked against him in that weight class to get a medal in Tokyo.
It's not a good weight class. What do you think is a good move for him going up? I mean, he's still very young, plenty of time to go up.
Man, I don't know. I have no idea. It depends on potential. Like I can't tell what sort of potential someone has. I mean, I think going up in weight, if he's a 73 now.
Yeah.
Right? 73?
Yeah, I believe so.
Or is he a 67?
73.
No, he's a 73.
Yeah.
So it'd be a 73 kilo to now go to 81. I mean, dude, it's not going to get him any more competitive. It's going to probably place him in the exact same place, even if he goes up in 5 kilos in both lifts, right? So that added body weight gain comes with an added necessary total.
Yeah,
so
you just have to make that pick of, is the body weight going to reflect that much in his total? Because he's someone that I've seen as like really knocking on his ceiling for quite some time now. I think his ceiling is here, and I think he's very, very close to it, in my opinion.
And being a natural... like a natural lifter, at least to the bounds we know, you know, it's one of the things that people who are listening, like as far as being natural or not, like, he's going to get tested by USADA. And like, when USADA knocks on your fucking door, like, they don't fuck around, and they're going to catch you, and they're not going to save you. There's no corruption there. They're a bunch of assholes. Thank God they are. Like, they really are. Like, yeah. If you have international listeners and people think like USADA is a joke, they're fucking not. They're a bunch of Nazis, and they're going to get you, and they want to pop you. Okay. So if he is doping or not, more power to him, because he hasn't been caught, and these people come knock on his door when he's not ready. He could be taking things that get out of his system fast, but who knows if that's true or not. All I know is, like, when someone has to deal with that level of testing, they can't consume the level of drugs that other countries might. So if he's clean, man, one of the only ways for someone like that can go up is to gain body weight, you know, as you get, you know, mature more into your adult life.
And there are goods and bads with that drug testing, the seriousness of USADA versus other countries. With USADA, you know up front who's going to be there, who's tested positive, who hasn't. With other countries, you know, it's a little bit of a hit or miss in terms of if they're going to be banned for the Olympics, who's going to be showing up at championships, things like that. And you mentioned her, because I'm a huge fan of her as well, Loredana Toma. How crushed are you that she's likely not going to be in Tokyo because of some of the issues that Romania has run into in terms of drug testing?
Well, I don't know. You know, you're a federation. You're a big federation, you know, like, if you keep fucking up, shit's going to happen. You know, I actually talked to Nat from Hook Grip about the Bulgarian 16-year-old who did a 205 jerk at 70 or at 81 kilos.
Which was offensive. I personally am very offended by that.
Yeah. And, you know, I don't know. I mean, all I would say is, like, drugs are most likely happening. Guys, where there's smoke, there's fire. I mean, it's Bulgaria. Okay. Their history with drugs is incredibly prevalent. It's a 16-year-old who less than 3 years prior was clean and jerking 140.
He's drinking his milk.
Yeah. It's unlikely that he wasn't on drugs, right? But the egregiousness of that and the fact that, well, how can he get away with it? Well, I'll tell you how. Like, is there a Bulgarian drug testing federation? I don't know. Do they go and are they going to go and fucking not? Like, here's the deal. Like, with USADA for us, it's like USADA doesn't give a fuck about USA weightlifting. The group, like USAW, they don't care about USAW. If you're in a testing pool, you're getting tested, and I'm not going to tell USAW shit until you get popped. Like, I'm going to test you whenever I want, however I want. In Bulgaria, in, you know, even places like Ukraine, Romania, like, do you really think that there's going to be an operation that exists outside the scope of the federation where they're just going to go and show up to someone's door and make them, you know, and catch them doing drugs? Like, if there's testing at all, they're going to give that test result right back to the federation that wants these lifters to compete. So what Nat was saying to me was that there is only a net positive to continue taking drugs on a ridiculous level, because we have consistently not punished these countries. You know, Bulgaria simply does not give a fuck until you say, all right, the next two Olympiads, you're out. You're no longer allowed to send more than like one lifter, you know, to world events. None of your lifters can qualify, like certain things like that, right? Until we start doing things like that, drug use is just going to continue to keep happening and be rampant. And that's, you know, Romania has broken the drug rules thousands of times. I mean, Loredana Toma herself was popped as a junior.
Yep.
And it's always interesting to see lifters who are popped early on in their career and they continue to progress as if nothing happened. You know, Lasha being the biggest
happening.
One.
Yeah. Lasha getting banned and then not being tested. What was it? He wasn't tested at all during his banned period, wasn't he?
Yeah.
That's the story.
Yeah, that's the story. But, you know, they'll do anything they can to protect him. I think, yeah, it's just ridiculous.
So, and that's okay. So that's kind of like one of the overarching issues of this conversation when I reached out to you to sit down was like, this is seems like a very logical point where the IWF steps in to save their sport, to protect their sport, but they don't. And then you made an entire video. I love that video, the CrossFit warm-up during the World Championships. Chef's kiss. Great content creation there, guys. So I'd actually like to hear you kind of expand upon your point. I believe you said something to the effect that the IWF is taking an active role in destroying their own sport or just not stepping up to protect their sport.
Yeah, no, they're definitely taking an active role. The problem is this. It's like when you build a house of cards, the rebuilding phase, like there's no infrastructure at all, right? They're whole infrastructure was making a ton of money off of very corrupt things. And there was a lot of great lifting happening. So that was their system. And now we decimated it and we're going to continue to decimate it. And what that takes is very innovative people who are very intuitive and very like excitable and like ready to take on a new challenge, i.e. young people. Need to step up and change this sport, but there's no money. So if you're running a social, so the social media campaign for IWF is pathetic. And that's what I pointed out. They, you know, they farm their social media to other places and the other places know nothing about the sport or the goings on in the sport, right? Imagine if the UFC, if there was, you know, like take one of the big events that just happened, Kamaru Usman knocking out Masvidal and not even mentioning it. And then later there's a picture of Kamaru from a different fight.
He's knocking out some other guy.
Yeah. Or just like, you know, just a random picture from another fight. Like that's what they do. But yep. I understand it, right? They pay a minimum fee. Like they just take it out of their marketing budget. They pay a minimum fee and some dude just posts random pictures. I get that. Okay. That doesn't mean it rocks. It fucking sucks. Because what it would take is someone to get out there, care about the sport, care about growing this thing and getting zero credit. And if you're going to get zero credit, God damn it, you better be getting paid. And they're not going to pay someone like that. That's the ultimate conclusion that I've come up with. So I think that the IWF really is kind of doomed in the way that they run things in the modern era. And they're not changing anything at all. It's ridiculous.
When you sit down and you think about things that they could possibly change, you know, outside of the social media, what comes to mind? Because you've got multi-billion-dollar sporting organizations, the NFL, the NBA, the European Premier League. Is there nothing that can be stolen from these? Like soccer? I'm sorry if you like soccer, but soccer is shit to watch. Weightlifting is way cooler. Soccer shouldn't be making more money than weightlifting.
Well,
and maybe I'm biased.
You're definitely biased.
Okay, perfect.
You're definitely biased. But I how could they improve as far as like eyes on the sport and excitement? Well, sure. You know, it used to be on the wide world of sports. Weightlifting used to be seen as a thing that was like, here's one of the strongest people in the world, you know? And what's interesting is we basically created the new weight classes and so that the old world records were gone. And that's a common move to make if you want to allow your athletes to break world records for a live audience to make your sport more exciting. And they haven't done that at all, right? you have to be able to get ABC to say, hey guys, like, look who's in town. Lashitel Hadza is here. And like, he has a potential to lift the most weight that's ever been lifted before. Right. And maybe things like that could occur. But I think even more than that, like, they've just been getting so much bad press that it's almost impossible for them to get around it. And the pitiful thing is that's why social media is so important, is because it's going to take away the bad press, right? That the more that you just, like, Liu Xiaojun hitting a world record, Li Dayin snatching a world record, God, all these amazing lifts occurred, and you could just show them endlessly right after they happen, repost, everyone posted everywhere. You know, the chatter about drugs can pop in there, but no one gives a shit. The sport's going to explode. Yeah. It's that simple. I mean, like, as much as that makes me sound like a millennial or a Gen Zer, like, that's the world we fucking live in. Like, social media does matter, so much so that it's the only thing. People think that, like, there's a difference between mainstream media and social media. No, they're the same. Social media is mainstream, right? So you don't just, you know, like I said, approach NBC Sports or ABC, whatever the fuck. But like, the reality is you might not even have to do that anymore. You know, like, just be better at promoting your own sport. It's that simple. Like, just be better at showing the videos of the badass dudes you have. People want to see that shit.
Yeah. I don't think that the sport should be something that I have to get commentating on one screen that's over here from Seb while I watch some Spanish dude's live stream of Pan Ams. It's like IWF could so easily reach out to, you know, high volume viewership content creators in the world of Olympic weightlifting to say, Zach.
Dude, it'd be so easy. It'd be so easy. It'd be so easy. I mean, that, come on, like, you could think of right now off the top of your head, you could think of 10 things to promote a sport like weightlifting. Easily. They won't do any of those. They're like, too.
Weightlifting has possibly one of the most dominant athletes that has ever existed, ever walked the earth right now. Lashitel Hadza is the equivalent of Wilt Chamberlain scoring 100 points one night, 101 the next night, 102 the next night. And every night he just goes out there and he breaks his own points record. And the IWF is like, you know, here's how to do a handstand pushup.
Yeah. Yeah. Here's a video of a CrossFit coach doing a handstand pushup to pushup workout. It's like, it's ridiculous. People are like, you know, that's not really that important. I'm like, it's the only thing that matters. It's the only thing that matters is promotion for your sport. That's why sports exist. People want to watch them.
If the IWF came and knocked on your door and they said, Zach, we need you to do some commentating for the Tokyo Games, do you think they would pay you more or less than a graduate assistantship in strength conditioning?
Less.
By a lot?
I don't know if that's possible because I was making minimum wage. Literally, in the state of Texas.
Making minimum wage?
Minimum wage, $7.25 an hour.
I feel like that's honestly lucky. Usually it's even less than that.
Usually it's nothing. Yeah, I mean, like, that's how it works. Like, interns get nothing, and then I was in a paid internship position, quote-unquote paid, and it was minimum wage in the state of Texas is $7.25 an hour. So, not ideal.
All right, but you know, it's not all negative here. I think that with the growth of your channel centered around weightlifting, with the growth of Seb's channel, Weightlifting House, people like Seek a Strength, people like Clarence, the viewership on weightlifting is taking an uptick, I think.
Yes, I think so too.
It's just going to be, is it enough and is it fast enough?
That's what I don't think. Like,
you've got two speeding trains racing at each other.
I said this in the last video that I made, the one about the IWF. It's like, if I walk down the street and I say, I'm a weightlifting coach, do you know what that means?
Oh, so you're like a bodybuilder.
No, they wouldn't know the first thing about what that means. If I said, I'm an Olympic weightlifting coach, maybe not, still probably not. Still probably wouldn't know what the fuck that means.
No.
You know, if you Do you remember weightlifting when you were a child? Like, do you remember the sport of weightlifting when you were a child?
I remember on TV. I remember watching Hossein Rezazadeh, and I was like, I don't know what this dude is doing, but he is a burly boy, and that barbell looks rather heavy. That is the extent of my viewership of weightlifting as a child.
That's exactly mine as well. It's the same. It's like, put yourself in that position, and that's the world.
Yep.
That's where the world is. It's not like we have the names of, like, I didn't know what those movements were. I didn't know anything. They just did this thing. I don't know what it is. I don't know anything. I just know there's a guy doing a thing. And I saw it on the Olympics because they showed it for 5 seconds. That is the highest extent of everyone in the world's knowledge of weightlifting that's outside of this community. And that's a lot of fucking people, man. And I live, you know, I live in Austin. If I walk down the street on like a crowded Friday night, I actually might want to do this for a video, just interview people, just be like, do you know what Olympic weightlifting is? And just like hold the microphone up to them and just see what they say. And I would guarantee like 99% of them would say the wrong thing or wouldn't know anything at all.
Oh yeah.
And so that's what I mean. It's like, I don't know if a sport like that can sustain itself. If it's,
but that's kind of a defeatist mentality, because you've got something like a sport like bodybuilding, which is like it just astronomically more boring than weightlifting. And I mean, shows like,
yeah, but Olympia, everyone is a bodybuilder though, because if you go to the gym and you do like chest press and bicep curl, you're a bodybuilder. You know, everyone knows what a big jack dude is. Everyone knows what, you know, bodybuilders don't train insofar as like working on skills. So it's not an Olympic sport in that sense. It's just it's like a whatever, you know? I think also this is just indicative of Olympic sports as it is like, if you were to ask the average American if they know what judo is, they would say, I have no fucking idea. I know they wear like a karate outfit and that's it. I don't know what the rules are. I don't know anything about it. And, you know, that makes sense, but that's also because the sport itself is just an Olympic sport. You know, there are some hobbyist judo players, but it's very unlikely. You know, jiu-jitsu helps out with that a little bit, but even still, it's like we're starting to see, because the barbell exists in gyms, that we're starting to see that's like, oh, that's a barbell with bumper plates. Like, I know that. You know, Olympic weightlifting is what I do, even though it's just like all you do is you use that. You know what I mean? The familiarity of Olympic weightlifting, yeah, people think is a lot similar to what they do. So the exposure is there, but the knowledge of the sport and the necessary things for the sport to succeed just aren't there as well.
Yeah, I can see that. Wow, what a doomer conversation we've had here, Zach. It's taken a very negative turn. You light me up with something positive. What's good going on in your life lately? You hit any PRs recently?
No. I'm kind of like over. I don't really compete in weightlifting anymore because.
Are you still working with Max?
Yeah. Well, I'm still a coach for Juggernaut Training Systems. So I coach and I train still. I still, you know, snatch, clean and jerk and back squat, front squat, all that. But I just taken a step away from competing. And I don't mind it, you know. For me, it's like I'm so tall that if I wanted to continue to compete, I would compete as a super heavyweight. And I'm just not interested in being fat as I get into my mid 30s, you know. Yeah. So
you would have to like calorically castrate yourself to get up to being a very competitive super heavyweight. But honestly, I mean, I'm here for it. I want to see the 140 kilo ZT.
Yeah, I don't even like, there's no part of me that wants to do that.
What's
zero.
The heaviest you've ever been?
I think I was like 115.
Yeah. And stairs start to look a little scary, don't they?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And like when you taking a shit and looking down is a whole different meaning. Cause you got an actual belly.
Yeah. There's nothing there anymore. It's just you and the belly, just you, yeah, and the power gut. All of a sudden your bar path is shit because you got to go out around the belly. That's unfortunate.
Well, it wasn't at that level, but you know,
it wasn't Lasha level hanging over the belt. No, But you're looking pretty svelte. Let me throw you some compliments here lately. You're looking pretty svelte in some of those photos.
Yeah, that's because I'm not competing anymore. Like, I want to get fit. It's usually how it works for me. It's like, I want to just stay just naturally fit. There's really no point in being fat if it doesn't promote a sport. And, you know, like, that was it for weightlifting. Like, I just didn't really care about my fitness. I wanted to be strong as fuck. Now that I don't compete, you know, I want to be in decent shape because I'm a human. And so I started doing a lot of jiu-jitsu, and that's been a blast. It's a great way for me to stay in shape and stay focused and learn a new skill. Whereas CrossFit is like
too tall for that.
Well, it's a great workout. That's what I'm saying. I would never compete in CrossFit, right? But I think it's a great workout. The thing is, I'm not learning anything.
Yeah.
You know, it's not like jiu-jitsu. Like, I'm learning every day and it's keeping my mind stimulated. It's like meditative in that way. It's super intense on my brain. It helps me keep going. So that's why I decided to do that.
You mentioned that you're a coach at Juggernaut, but soon enough, the AI at Juggernaut will take all of your jobs. So what is your plan for when that inevitably happens before the end of the year? What is our long-limbed Leviathan of weightlifting have planned for the rest of 2021?
For 2021, first off, the AI is really cool. But, you know, the value of a program, like a coach, I'd say, like, when you hire a coach, like 10 to 15% of that coach's worth comes from his programming, right? Everything else is why you have a coach, not the yep. program. So, you know, if you get an AI, whatever, you now have, you know, a 10 to 15% portion of a coach. So it's not like the best thing in the world, but it is pretty cool. I will admit. For the future for me, you know, just continue to coach my guys. Nationals is coming up, so I think I have a couple lifters who are going to lift there. The rest of Team Juggernaut will have a couple lifters there as well. That's going to be fun. I'm just going to keep on making content, man, and keep on having fun. I've been, you know, a musician and playing music my whole life, so I started to write and record some music in a studio, and so I want to keep doing that. Again, another fun hobby, but it could also turn to something a little bit more intense if people like my music. If they don't, well, then at least I tried.
Fuck them.
And so that's it. That's me. That's what I like to do. That's what I'm gonna keep doing. Yeah.
All right, folks. Well, you know, you got anything to circle back to before we send this thing off into the sunset?
No, man. This is great. I don't want to jinx a good podcast.
You don't want to muddy it up? Nope. Yeah, don't fuck it up. Seriously, just stop. Stop right there.
I'm done.
All right, guys. Thanks for coming out. Thanks for watching. Like, comment, subscribe, do all that YouTube shit, because the algorithm stays fucking your boy. We will see you on the next one. As always, guys, stay gifted.
See ya.